The first impression that comes to our mind about any college: tall buildings, big classrooms, large lobby areas, thick books, IT labs, assignments, class tests, and projects. Nothing besides that. Every hour, minute, second spent here help us carving and shaping our persona, cultivating innovative mindsets for the challenging world. Learning is a lifelong process. Sharing knowledge, inculcating values of life, spark the innovative horizons of mind. Fun and frolic is the nature of every nook and corner here. A daily dose of thrill we are sure to get here.
When it comes to abuse, you believe there's no way out. There's always help. There's always a way out. Good morning to one and all present here. I, Hani Khurana, and Jigyasa Khanna, student of BJMC first year, welcome you all to the program on International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women, organized by SPARC, the Student Council of DME Media School. The United Nations General Assembly has designated November 25th as the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. The premise of the day is to raise awareness of the fact that women around the world are subjected to rape, domestic violence, and other forms of violence. Furthermore, one of the main aims of the day is to highlight that the scale and the true nature of issue is often hidden.
As we move further, I would like to invite Dr. Amrish Saxena, Dean DME Media School, to share his thoughts on this day.
Thank you, Hani. So this day we are meeting to have this event for the purpose of basically creating awareness on the issue of violence against women. So this is a day which is declared by the United Nations as the International Day for Elimination of Violence Against Women. And obviously there can be no two opinions on this, that this is a very vital area. And interestingly, if I can tell you something as to what I have been doing for the last 4 or 5 days, I was in Maldives and we were part of a workshop, which was on strengthening a gender sensitive media environment in Maldives. So this was a training program to train the journalists of the Maldives. So that they, in their reporting, in their writing, in the media, in whatever kind of presentation, depiction, treatment they give to the women, that should be more equitable, that should be more gender neutral, as we call it. So till yesterday, the sessions were on, and today I'm participating, I'm there in this session. So the whole issue is basically, so many dimensions, so many aspects of the whole issue is. This is an issue which is not confined to any one particular country, whether it's India or Maldives or other country. This is an issue which has a global ramifications, wherein the basic premise is that we are not, as a society, we have failed, in fact, to accord that status to women, which they are entitled to. The difference could be there from one society to another, from one country to another. But then, as far as the whole gender issue is concerned, since in most parts of the world, we have been having a patriarchal society. So men are always dominating whichever country, whichever sector, whichever profession. And when a gender is considered better and another gender is considered inferior, so that prepares the ground for all kind of exploitation, suppression, oppression, whatever we call it. So in fact, we have failed to recognize women as the human beings. So that's the beginning point of all kind of problems, all kind of miseries that women face. So the first thing which I believe, that if we start treating women as humans, as equal to us. So if there is more equity in society, more parity in society, then obviously men and women, and not only the women, in fact, nowadays the debate has further expanded that we are talking about the people of all genders. So if we have been unfair to women, so this can easily be imagined how unjust and unfair we as a society would have been to the people of other genders. So we have to have the fair treatment. And then once we provide that treatment, once we have that kind of treatment, then obviously there will be no issue of violence. So this is something which we have to raise at every forum. As I gave you the example, whether we are talking to the journalists who are mainly involved in the content creation at different platforms, or we are talking about the students, the youth, everybody has to be made aware of. So there is a need of creating more awareness on this issue. And today's program has in fact been organized for that purpose only, because if we are discussing, deliberating on this issue, then we will be more aware that we ourselves are not involved in any such kind of practices which are against women or which are against the dignity of women. And obviously that will be the beginning point of this whole exercise. So I hope that this today's session will be fruitful in this regard, and we will finally emerge as more informed, more aware after Mr. Anuj Agrawal enlightened us all on all aspects of this whole issue of violence against women, as to and how we can put a check on this socially, legally, constitutionally, and otherwise. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, sir. What is the identity of a woman? What is her capacity? We see her evolve around the cruelty that surrounds her, yet we keep questioning her ability. Here's presenting Stree Meri Pehchan, a poetic performance by Spark members Ananya Verma and MS Divisri.
Abla aur nirbal hoon main, meri apni koi pehchan nahi, ubhog ka patra hoon main.
ये सोचने वाला समाज अक्सर भूल जाता है.
महाकाल की महाकाली हूँ मैं, हाँ शिव की गौरी हूँ तो शंकर की शक्ति भी हूँ मैं. कृष्ण की राधा हूँ और राम की सीता भी, हरि की लक्ष्मी हूँ तो विष्णु की वैष्णवी भी हूँ मैं. जीवन का आरंभ हूँ मैं तो सृष्टि का अंत भी हूँ मैं. कभी एक माँ, कभी एक बहन, कभी एक बेटी भी हूँ मैं. कभी अग्नि परीक्षा में भस्म हुई सती हूँ तो कभी अग्नि से जन्मी याज्ञ सेनी हूँ मैं. ज्ञानदाता सरस्वती हूँ तो कभी क्रोध में प्रचंड अंबिका हूँ मैं. शिव के तांडव का भाव हूँ मैं, हर अंत का आरंभ हूँ.
प्रकाश में अंधकार में, रुद्र के क्रोध की ज्वाला में, शिव के मस्तक की तीसरी नेत्र.
पर मेरे धैर्य को मेरी विवशता और मेरे मौन को मेरी स्वीकृति ना समझना, क्योंकि पल में दुख हरता तो पल में जीवन हरता हूँ मैं. समाज सही कहता है, पुरुष होता है, स्त्री होती है, जन्म भी होता है, मृत्यु होती है, भय होता है, किंतु शक्ति होती है.
हर लोक सा सुंदर भाव हूँ मैं और नर्क का प्रचंड ताप हूँ मैं. हर घर का आधार हूँ तो उस घर की इकलौती दरार हूँ मैं. गंगा सी निर्मल हूँ और यमुना सी शीतल भी, लेकिन हर फटते ज्वालामुखी की भस्म कर देने वाली आग हूँ मैं. अंत में, आरंभ में, धैर्य में और प्रेम में, धर्म में, परित्याग में, हर जीवन का वास में, जीवनी हूँ और मृत्यु भी, अमृत हूँ और विष भी.
कभी एक दिए की जलती लौ हूँ तो कभी एक वन को भस्म कर देने वाली अग्नि हूँ मैं. शक्ति के बिना तो शिव भी शव है, उस शव को शिव बनाने वाली शक्ति हूँ.
सत्य में, श्वास में, अंत में, आरंभ में, हर अंत का आरंभ में.
What a heart-wrenching performance indeed. Now, I would like to introduce our guest for today, Mr. Anuj, who is a practicing lawyer and qualified as a chartered accountant in 2003. Mr. Anuj is a graduate from Sri Ram College of Commerce, Delhi University, after securing top rank in his batch at St. Xavier School, Delhi. Having a vast experience in handling various kinds of litigation before the Honorable Supreme Court of India, various high courts, commissions, forums, boards, and tribunals, he was nominated as additional standing counsel, post equivalent to additional advocate general in states, for the Government of Delhi before the Honorable High Court of Delhi in May 2015, being the youngest then to achieve the feat at the age of 34 years. Till date, he has represented the interests of his various clients, both individuals and organizations, in over 3,000 cases. Mr. Anuj has represented Delhi Police in a PIL concerning women and child safety in Delhi, instituted by the Delhi Police in the matter involving revamping of Chani Chowk, Government of India through Ministry of Commerce involving Basmati trade dispute initiated by Pakistan before Delhi High Court on its own motion as an aftermath of Nirbhaya incident, and many such cases. He has represented several corporate firms, banks, and government departments, and obtained his training as a mediator from Strauss Institute for Dispute Resolution, Pepperdine University, California, USA, and impaneled as a mediator with Delhi High Court Mediation Center Samadhan upon selection by a panel of honorable judges of Delhi High Court. Now, I would like to invite Sir to address the audience.
Thank you, Jigyasa, and it was a wonderful performance by the students, and thank you for the kind introduction. I am grateful to Mr. Saxena in particular for having considered me worthy of sharing my experiences before all of you. And it is one topic, of course, which is very close to our hearts, because women constitute 50%, almost 50% of the population. And Swami Vivekananda once said, like a bird cannot fly with one wing. Obviously, our society cannot move ahead, without one pair of legs that we have, which supports the entire system, which is women. And as we have seen in historically also, starting from the beginning, this has always been a concern. But to begin with, I would just like to share certain statistics which UN provides on its website. And it says that nearly one in three women have been abused in their lifetimes. And during these stressful times, during wars, during pandemics, like we recently experienced, the number goes to as high as 67 to 70%, which is like 2/3 of the population. And only one in 10 women can, one in 10, I mean, one in 10, 10% of the victims gather enough courage to actually report the matter to police or to the state. Besides that, I have personally seen once even they report the matter and police starts taking over the investigation and other aspects, victim gets so traumatized by the whole experience, they either wish to withdraw or they just want to, they buckle under the pressure. It is I'm sure it is a matter of common knowledge that sometimes women even go through so much of stress post reporting the incident that they actually end up committing suicides. Victimization one after the other, it just becomes perpetual. So, and even to raise awareness, this is also what I got to know, that this year's theme, in fact, I have always believed that, addressing a group of people or coaching in any manner is the best way to learn. So during this process, I also learned that this year, the awareness theme for the UN is orange. It's named Orange the World. So it's like painting the world orange. And it is for ending violence against women. Right, and the orange has been actually portrayed as a brighter future for free of violence against women. So, and it says be part of an orange movement. So, see, I mean, it is so disheartening also to see that despite so many years of civilization and so to say, continuous efforts to make women independent, even UN, it could have been, although it's not, it was never a solace, but still, had it been a problem specific to our country, we would have understood because of our customs, because of our, literatures or whatever, we could be facing these problems. But it seems to be Mr. Amrish said, that it seems to be a problem, a global problem. It's like a global pandemic. It's nothing less than that. And it is good that, India has taken a lot of steps. India as a country, we are lucky to be, I'm sure most of you are probably residents of Delhi. We are lucky that we are in a country, in a city where these issues are taken up very seriously, and governments have done, obviously evolvement of any society, any government, any ecosystem is a slow process. It takes its own time and course. But then we have definitely come a long way forward. It's another thing that the procedures are so tedious at times that the victim becomes, keeps, I mean, the victimization continues in that sense. But India had, in fact, India had ratified, as soon as it got its independence, it ratified Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which spoke about women freedom. No, and UN General Assembly in 93 defined violence as a physical, sexual, or psychological harm suffering to women, including deprivation of liberty, whether occurring in public or private life. So the definitions have from time to time been changed, and we all know that they have been enlarged so as to protect the integrity and the modesty of a woman. In our society, as we know, back in the times, if we talk from the historical perspective, we were in Vedic times and women were at par with men. In fact, they were at a better pedestal than men. I mean, motherly status was given to all the goddesses, even to women at home. And they were treated very sacredly, whatever they used to. In fact, it was once said that they were given the rank of annadata. I mean, they were supposed to be the ones providing food to everybody at home, and only if a woman cooks, it was supposed to be sacred. These practices over the years became so vitiated, and men, for their own advantage, of course, and for their own personal, satisfying their ego at times, they would actually twist the entire perspective to suit their own purpose. So, which has been happening since those times. And from the Vedic times, we have, of course, came to Gupta age, where all the practices of female infanticide, child marriage, parda, jauhar, sati, slavery, they became prominent. And not only that, especially when we faced Mughal era, and invaders from other countries came to India, they started objectifying women. They started treating them as commodities. Women were not even free to move around, on the roads or in the society. The emperors would see them and put them in their harems. So it just kept getting deteriorated from time to time. And then, thankfully, I would say the British era came, where there was some kind of an awareness, when people used to see like their queen, the kind of treatment they used to give to their women. Although we say that it's a global problem, and inside the doors, obviously, it's all sorts of dark ages are prevalent since those times. But then, the good thing is that there came a judicial system, there came a constitution, there came treaties that were signed by India on the global platform. And the reform movement, so to say, got initiated, which India was also a part of. And it generated social consciousness, you know, amongst women. Because till then, the idea was to keep them unaware behind the closed doors of the house so that they are completely unaware as to what transpires outside home or in the society in general. So after our independence, a lot of legal and statutory provisions came into existence. I would like to talk about them because the main problem that we see today. So I have been into practice for 17 years now. And I have represented, like Jigyasa mentioned, I have represented Government of India, and I'm currently representing Government of Delhi and Delhi Police as well. So, I mean, when clients approach us, you know, thankfully, this digitization also has happened. So these days, we encounter clients who have already Googled about their problem. So they are aware, you know, but they are half aware because either they overread or misread something. The information which is being provided on the internet. So that's another problem that we get to face at times as professionals. But Constitution per se of India provides for so many articles. It lays out so many articles where the protection of women or the rights of women and the citizens equally have been protected. So I would like to specifically mention the provisions because it still it seems like a big problem where awareness is an issue. Even in the urban areas, leaving rural areas aside, even in the urban areas, people are not aware of their rights. And that creates problems of all sorts, including women and whatever molestations that they have to face or the situations that they have to face. So Article 14 is the basic principle or the basic article which provides equality to all the citizens of the country, right? So it means that, and it is, if it is read with article in conjunction with Article 15, Article 15 prohibits any kind of discrimination on the grounds of religion, race, caste, or sex, or place of birth. So on gender cannot be a reason to apply laws differently. No, that is what it means. So all the laws are equally applicable to all the genders. And Article 16 is for providing equality of opportunities in matters of public employment. We all know that, in fact, I remember being part of one of the matters where the Air Force used to discriminate between women pilots. They would not hire women pilots. One of the reasons was that it would also amount to some sort of, there will be complaints against men folk. So they, you can see that just because men folk may perform an act which they are not supposed to do, which they are not supposed to perform in the first place or commit in the first place, women were being deprived of a right, which was a valuable right of serving this nation by way of armed forces. So High Court struck down that provision as violative of Article 14 and 15 and 16, equality of employment, of opportunities in public employment. Then Article 19, freedom of speech and expression. See how beautifully our constitution has been drafted. We all know that in today's times also, and I'm talking about the urban population of the country, including the urban population, if women are vocal, they are considered, they are given names, their labels are put on them. So it is still considered to be appropriate for women to keep being a mute spectator in a family or in the social gathering. The moment they try to open up or they try to express their views, so they it's not taken lightly. So, although we may have come a long way, like I said, in the form of legislations, But as a societal mental block, there is a societal mental block where we do not actually treat them equally. Then Article 21 provides for protection of life and personal liberty. Article 39, there are so many directives of directive principles of state policy. So amongst which, so securing men and women the right to an adequate means of livelihood is important. Then equal pay for equal work. I have seen that also happening in many organizations. Women are paid lesser than men. And all sorts of weird excuses are given. I mean, when this is done, that you are physically lesser capable than men. You have your different timings and so on and so forth. So, and these are excuses just given to women. I mean, generalized excuses which are given to women for paying less for their same kind of effort that they have put in. Article 39A talks about promoting justice on basis of equal opportunity and to provide legal free legal aid. So that has come a long way. I'm also a part of Legal Aid Society in the High Court of Delhi. And I have seen like women, when they approach us, they have no clue. They come to, especially from slum areas in Delhi or the rural areas of Delhi. They would come and they would have no idea as to what course law can take to bring justice to them. They simply come as a vulnerable victim, and they will just keep their hands folded, and they will treat us like gods. And we have to tell them that, please, it's your right. Please don't feel as if we are doing a favor or anybody is doing a favor to you. It's your right. Please avail it. Article 42 is for provision of securing just and humane conditions of work and for maternity relief. So that became a big issue. I mean, obviously, there are biological reasons why women have to have a break in career. But earlier, I remember, so they were supposed to apply for re-employment. Their candidature was made to be a fresh candidature post the maternity leaves. No, they were literally terminated from service on being pregnant, on delivering a child, or not being able to attend offices for a year. But then over the course of last few decades, there has been a tremendous change in that sense. It is the right to maternity leave was acknowledged as a right, as a basic right of a woman, of being. It's a pleasure. It's a great feeling for a woman to become a mother. And she was made to feel she was victimized for being a mother. So how cruel or how discriminative, the set of rules could be. And then Article 51AE, a capital A, small e, it says that it's a duty of every citizen to promote harmony and to renounce practices derogatory to dignity of women. So the constitution writers knew that what kind of problems are going to emerge in the evolving society after the British left. So they were kind enough to include these provisions in the constitution. And of course, we have several legislations by now in place where, rights of women have been protected over the years. Or even we are still in the process. There are several bills which are pending approval in the parliament. But we have still, I would enumerate a few legislations which are there for, especially for women empowerment or securing their rights or securing their dignity. One is the Immoral Traffic Prevention Act of 1956. So as the name itself suggests, that it was a very crucial act when it was brought into force to provide any kind of forceful trafficking, human trafficking. Then the Dowry Prohibition Act, which came into existence in 1961. Dowry Prohibition Act importantly applies to all the religions in the country. So it's not a practice which is religion specific. It's a practice which was pervasive, which was prevalent. Now, if you look at the history of dowry, the entire basis, I mean, I read it somewhere, the entire basis of the practice was to, at the time of marriage, it was felt that, you know, women were going to be a part of a different family. So they ceased to have rights in their own family. So to give their share of the property, father used to, at whatever worth his property used to be, and whatever share out of that women, the woman concerned must get, he would at the time of marriage only give away that part of property to her, you know, as gifts, as whatever she may require in future for securing her future. So that was a noble thought probably to ever start this practice. But I mean, how it was molded over the period, girls were seen as a liability, and this amount was seen as a, you know, as a award or a, I mean, reward for the groom to take the daughter away from them. So to discharge that liability, see how crooked it became. So in 1961, the Dowry Prohibition Act was brought into force. Then the Indecent Representation of Women Prohibition Act, which came in 1986. The Commission of Sati Prevention Act, it came as late as 1987, you know, where sati practices were prohibited. Then Protection of Women from Domestic Violence, it came in 2005. Section 498A was brought in the Indian Penal Code to avoid any atrocities on the basis of dowry demands, and it protects importantly even from the male live-in partners, you know, and the relatives. So those are important aspects that we sometimes forget. So these are, and then sexual harassment of women at workplace, it was enacted as early as 2013. No, there are constant trainings that go on in the corporate houses. Every corporate house is required to have this act implemented. There has to be an internal complaints committee to which a woman employee can report any sort of molestation or any kind of sexual crime that has happened against her. And they are then supposed to take appropriate action. It's a wonderful step because, like I said earlier, it used to happen that, and even now it happens that women find it very difficult to go to police for the reason of social embarrassment. Internal complaints committee is an internal body of an organization, and it also has social activist. One of the panel members is a social activist. So they are specially trained in that area, and whenever they receive a complaint, so they try to deal with it internally. They try to resolve the matter amicably between the victim and the accused. And they try to negotiate the terms there and then. And if the woman feels satisfied, so most of the times the accused is also even retrenched, or, you know, his services are terminated. But if something short of that is possible, then they try to get the matter resolved so that the harmonious atmosphere may be maintained. It's a great initiative because it sort of really gives a confidence to a woman that it will the confidential proceedings will take place, and there will be a complete confidentiality as regards her identity, and the matter will not travel to the state agencies, and there is no threat of information getting leaked even to her family members. So that way it provides a great, it's been a great initiative, and we have personally conducted a lot of trainings, you know, in a lot of corporates to enable them to deal with such crisis whenever they face such crisis at workplace. Then the Criminal Law Amendment Act 2013, you know, it came into existence. It was specially passed by the parliament on 3rd of February 2013, within almost 2 months from the date of the unfortunate incident of Nirbhaya gang rape. So where they tried to widen the definition of sexual offenses against women, you know, which and police was made accountable, because earlier it used to happen that even if a woman victim is gathering courage to approach police, so police would not register an FIR. So it was a big lapse on the part of the police or the state. So it non-registration of an FIR was also made an offense. So that was it was an imperative, and it was a milestone, one of the milestones, I would say. And to bring within the four corners of the definition, even the sexual voyeurism, stalking, and in a lot of ways, the definition was enlarged. So to bring them also as sexual offenses. And then discontinuing the practice of examination of the sexual history of the victim. So that also used to be a great, lot of girls would never approach police because they would know that their sexual history would be examined. So, it was sort of victimization. Like I said, the state itself was victimizing the victims. So a lot of things happened, and Hindu Marriage Act, of course, in 1955 had been passed, where polygamy, polyandry, child marriage were prohibited as practices, and women were given equal rights to divorce and remarry. And then Hindu Succession Act was amended to make women equally entitled to family property. And then this amendment took place in 2005. So you can imagine for how many years, women were not considered, like I said earlier, it was as if all the ties from a woman or from a girl child was severed as soon as she got married, used to get married. And then Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act, childless woman was given a right to adopt a child. Divorced woman was given a right to claim maintenance from the family of the deceased husband. So all of these are such important provisions. And I would like to mention that, in fact, I had mentioned it to Dr. Saxena also, that I was part of one very important litigation. And I think Jigyasa also mentioned in the introduction that after the Nirbhaya gang rape case in Delhi, there was a petition which was initiated by Delhi High Court. And it was in court on its own motion petition, which means that court felt that it's a matter of grave public importance. And they initiated those proceedings just for taking steps for ensuring women's safety in the city. And I would like to just point out a few important directions that have been passed by court. So we can see that sometimes judicial activism is sometimes criticized also by the critics. But judicial activism, how important it becomes for an active judiciary to pass such directions, which can actually be very helpful. So under this particular litigation, the matter is still on before Delhi High Court, and it's an ongoing continuous process. But so far, whatever has been done, I would just like to highlight in next 2 minutes. One is installation of the CCTV cameras. So there was identification of dark stretches across the city. There were a lot of dark patches. So those, all the local authorities of the particular district were asked to identify all those dark patches within their district. They were lightened up by putting, street lights, prominent street lights in the area, and also CCTV cameras. Then police helpline, special helpline was created, 112. Apart from 100 number that we have, a 112 was created pursuant to the directions of the Honorable High Court. Then PCR vehicles fitted with GPS systems, their numbers were increased. And in fact, now one of the proposals is going on where there is an emergency response support system, which would replace so it will be called mobile data. There will be a mobile data terminal instead of GPS system, existing GPS system in all the PCR vehicles. So that would help all the PCRs getting connected with each other. And if there is a requirement of more police personnel at the spot, they can instantly, the vehicle the system would immediately direct where they need to reach. So in this context, in fact, I remember Justice B.D. Ahmed was the concerned judge back in those days. And he asked, since I was appearing for Delhi police in the matter, so they asked me, like, what can we do to make Delhi police as efficient as Scotland Yard? So, you know, their response time should be less than a minute. Wherever there is a crime, reporting of the crime, it should just reach the spot within a minute or maybe less than 2 minutes. That's it. So Delhi police came up with a study. They conducted an internal study, and they came up with a figure of 1 lakh more personnel that they require. Current strength of Delhi police is between 85,000 to 90,000. And you can imagine, like, about 30,000 of those personnel are on VIP securities all the time. No, and then there are people who are supposed to, and it is such a big problem that investigation is being handled by the prosecution wing of Delhi police. So they are the same people who conduct the investigation, and then they are in charge of prosecuting the accused in the court also. So how much time is wasted in court's appearances? Those IOs are called to courts repeatedly. The investigations in other matters get hampered because of it. No, so it's a perennial problem which needs to be addressed, but we don't have sufficient numbers to augment all these changes in the system. Then two dedicated motorcycles were ordered to be stationed in each police station in the city. Then Malkhana registers, where police stocks their seized material and everything, whatever, the stolen vehicles. So there is a Malkhana. So Malkhana registers were digitized pursuant to directions passed by High Court in this matter. And then forensic science laboratories were asked to be personally examined, personally, we visited the forensic science laboratories. What we noticed was that police, investigating officer of the police, was allowed to meet the scientific officer of the FSL. No, the normal citizen could not go. Obviously, nobody should be allowed, because it's an independent investigating agency, FSL. They are supposed to give a neutral report. If the investigating officer goes and threatens, the scientific officer, the scientist there working at the FSL, that you must give the report one way or the other, you can imagine how detrimental it can be for the police investigation. Then sanctioning of additional posts, like I mentioned, and sensitization of police officials from time to time. So these were the steps or directions which were issued from time to time, and it has brought us to a significant step forward from where we stood way back in 2012. So these have been good 9 years in that sense, where things have actually improved. But still we see Nirbhaya, Unnao and Kathua gang rape cases. I mean, it's unfortunate. And a woman who is supposed to be, a caregiver, her status has been actually reduced to a service provider in the family. All the men folks, even daughters sometimes, but they treat their mothers as, some sort of a service provider. So we need to give respect to, we realize all this when we grow old. And even as a son, I would just feel that it's the duty of my mother to provide for whatever I'm asking for. But that's not the way it works. I mean, probably men learn it hard way when they get married. So then they start acknowledging the independence of a woman better, probably. And so that's those are my thoughts. But having said that, one last thought I would leave you with. I personally feel that mediation is a great way forward. So litigation has really tried hard to curb this menace, but it has not been as successful as we would have expected it to be till now. Mediation, I see as a great movement. It will be a change, great change, because the first thing that mediation proceedings do, in a neutral environment, they try to address the emotions, and it involves counseling of the victim. So in that sense, mediation is a great way forward, and I think that should be promoted in cases of sexual abuse. So that is why I said that the Act of 2013, Prevention of Sexual Harassment Against Women at Workplace, you know, is a great way forward because it's first, they first try to mediate the dispute between the victim and the accused. And that is what the approach should be. That is exactly how the approach should be, even for the police or even for the state for that matter, whenever a matter is reported or highlighted. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for listening to me patiently. I hope I was not boring. I mean, no, I just tried to keep it interesting with facts, figures, and examples. So
no, it was really interesting, and particularly the way you gave an insight as far as the constitutional, legal, and linking it to the social aspect. So that combination was really good.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for enlightening us.
Thank you.
Let's move further. And for the question answer round, I would like to invite Dr. Teenam Bora, Assistant Professor, DME Media School, to take the session forward. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Honey. Anand sir, I was listening very carefully, and some students were also dropping questions. One aspect of in two areas during the pandemic, violence against women has seen a lot of increase. One right. is domestic violence, and in terms of cyber crime, cyber right. violence.
Yes.
So can you throw some light upon these two areas and what legal policies have been framed
sure.
around these?
Sure. So as far as the domestic violence is concerned, it is very important for the society as a whole to be constructively busy, and it is important for them to be constructively, when I say constructively busy, it means they need to remain busy for earning their livelihoods. If, that's the best way to keep oneself busy constructively. And during obviously lockdown, brought before us a situation where everybody was, so there was so much of frustrations. People were retrenched from their services. They were not getting salaries. The landlords were not getting their rents. People were not able to run their businesses. So it brought in a lot of frustrations. And it is sad that, like I mentioned in the initial, initially in my address, that whenever there is a level of dissatisfaction which goes high in the society, women are made to feel the brunt of it, and that's not how it's supposed to work. And as far as the cyber stalking is concerned, I would say it's like women and men alike. And also, I have seen one of the Honorable High Court of Judges' account getting hacked on Facebook. In fact, it happened to me as well personally. So my account was hacked. I was in fact threatened that my pictures will be publicly posted after morphing them. So you can imagine the kind of pressure he was trying to create. Thankfully, I was a counsel for Delhi Police, so I could contact the right person in the police. But trust me, it was even hard for me. Firstly, it was a big mental trauma. Secondly, it was a very, I was not comfortable sharing this with anybody, even in my family, So, and I was shown those pictures. I was sent those pictures on WhatsApp, on my WhatsApp. And I was told that these pictures would be posted publicly. So then it was at 11 in the night. So that night I could not sleep. And then next day, first thing that I did was to talk to the concerned DCP, who is the DCP of the crime branch of Delhi Police. And then they told me that, sir, please stop attending all the calls of the victims. Simply block him. Their purpose is just to, malign, just to threat you by maligning your reputation. But they would not do anything of the sort. So I asked him why. So he told me, sir, in 99 out of the 100 cases, they are only interested in money. In 100 cases, in fact, 100 out of 100 cases, they are only interested in money, right? The moment they will post your pictures online. So there is once the cat is out of the bag, and then of course you are going to report the matter to the police, and there is an apprehension that they will be arrested. So that's one thing which I would like to tell everybody, that at any stage, if you are threatened, or if money is trying to be extorted, or you are being extorted in any other way, please don't give into that extortion at all. The moment you give into that extortion, the confidence of the accused goes much higher. And they, by very nature of it, are very timid people because they know that they are doing something illegal. And they don't want you to approach police. But if they actually happen to commit that crime, there are more chances of you approaching the police. So as far as cyber crime is concerned, what I'm trying to suggest is that it must be reported. It's a different thing. I understand that police, again, you know, is sometimes not very responsive. They treat it as a very casual offense. And but even in those circumstances, you don't have to, you know, get scared or give into the demands of the accused. Because that's been my personal, that is why I'm citing my personal example. And it becomes humiliating. So now what has happened is, like, after I reported it, after 20 days, they actually happened to arrest somebody whom I, of course, don't know. I'd only heard his voice. Now they want me to identify the accused. I can't identify him. I don't know who have they got. There may be an old score they wanted to settle and they probably got hold of someone. I don't know. I mean, I have to trust the police, but I'm just saying. So now on every date, I'm called to the police, to the court. And so I have to repeat the incident. So I can from my personal example, give you the sense of that victimization that even I have gone through. So it is hard, but it is important, again, still to report it. And not to get afraid at all by any kind of threat.
Another question that has come up is that, like you had also mentioned, that many people do not even report crime against them, because one of the reasons is the character assassination that comes along with it.
Right.
You know, the victim blaming, even by the policeman.
Right.
You know, if a girl goes to the police station and says that I was harassed or abused, then the first question would be that, why, what were you doing there at this hour? So what is the solution to this kind of attitude? You know, what measures can be taken?
I would not rule out, the way sometimes these special laws are also misused, you know. But unless and until the genuine reporting, the number of genuine reportings go high, there cannot be a situation where these things will stop attracting stigma along with them. You know, these incidents will become destigmatized. I mean, there needs to be a situation. Let's just talk about divorce cases. Maybe 20 years back in the society, divorce was seen with such a blatant, you know, crime, as if a couple has committed. They are going through divorce? I mean, it was a talk. It used to become the talk of the town. And it used to be a grapevine during the kitty parties, but no longer. People are no longer talking about it. So people just say it's like every house is, you know, going through the one matrimonial issue or the other. So every couple faces their own problems. So it is because people have taken that in the right spirit. Because see, we as a culture, we used to believe that marriage happens for 7 births or rebirths. So that is why there was a stigma attached to it. But now looking at the practical perspective where the way it stands today, I mean, two good people, it's not necessary that two good people are meant for each other. So even if after some time they just wish to move ahead in life, you know, without hampering the other aspects. So there's nothing bad about it. Likewise, the problem is right now there is more of a victimization and there is reporting of non-genuine cases. The number is higher. That is why the minuscule minority, which is actually, you know, which out of the reported cases, which actually faces that trauma, also get labeled. So if the genuine reportings go higher in number, I'm sure this problem will be, this will no longer be a problem.
Thank you, sir, for the insightful session. And I'm sure our students must have learned quite a few things. So now over to Honey once again.
It's my pleasure. Thank you, Tina.
Thank you, ma'am. Now let's see what students of DME have to say about violence faced by women in their day-to-day lives. have a look at Perception of the Common, Vox Pop presented by members of SPARC.
On 25th, we are celebrating International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. So, we would like to ask you some questions.
Will you ever justify this kind of act for any reason?
No, I will never justify this kind of act for anybody, let alone women, because violence cannot never be justified in any way.
No, I would not like to justify this act because iska basically koi justification hai hi nahi. Act hi aisa hai aur violence women ke against, violence kisi ke bhi against sahi nahi hoti. ठीक है, तो उस चीज़ का कोई भी जस्टिफिकेशन नहीं होता.
नहीं, जस्टिफिकेशन इस एक्ट में बिल्कुल भी काम नहीं आती, क्योंकि लोग ऐसे हीट ऑफ द मोमेंट में काम कर देते हैं और उनको भी बाद में रियलाइज होता है.
इस एक्ट का कोई जस्टिफिकेशन तो नहीं है, कोई दे भी नहीं सकता. और द रीज़न कि किस वजह से ये होते हैं, व्हाट आई फील, एक तो फ्रस्ट्रेशन रहता है, सिचुएशंस कई बार ऐसी होती हैं, बट वो फ्रस्ट्रेशन भी कभी चीज़ को जस्टिफाई नहीं कर सकती.
फॉर श्योर आई विल नॉट जस्टिफाई दिस एक्ट बिकॉज दिस इज नॉट अ थिंग दैट शुड बी देयर. देयर शुड बी अ प्रॉपर एजुकेशन फॉर इट.
व्हाट अकॉर्डिंग टू यू शुड बी द पनिशमेंट फॉर दिस?
पनिशमेंट इसकी पहले हमें इसके अच्छे से एविडेंस लेने चाहिए और एविडेंस के हिसाब से इनको पनिशमेंट देनी चाहिए.
इट कैन डिपेंड ऑन द लेवल ऑफ द क्राइम. लाइक इफ इट्स अ it's a harassment or it's eve teasing, the person should be locked up in jail for at least 3 years and should be educated, because in my opinion only uneducated people do such shameful acts. And if it's a serious crime, like if it's a rape or it's a violence, then the person should be given death sentence, I guess.
Basically aise aadmi ko ekdam se khula to nahi chhodna chahiye, sabke liye harmful hai. अभी अपने बीवी बच्चों के साथ नहीं है तो कल को किसी और के लिए वो हार्मफुल होगा. फ्रस्ट्रेशन यहाँ नहीं तो कहीं ना कहीं तो निकालेगा, वन वे और अदर वो निकलती है.
पनिशमेंट शुड बी द डेथ, बट द एजुकेशन इज द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट पार्ट आई थिंक, सो दैट इफ दे विल एजुकेट पीपल सो इट शुड नॉट ओनली हैपन.
जिस तरीके से अगर किसी के साथ वायलेंस हुई है, सेम जिसने करी है उसके साथ, उस तरीके से करना चाहिए, क्योंकि उसको पता चलेगी क्या समझाने के ऊपर कैसे वो उस चीज से गुजरता है.
हाउ डू यू थिंक वी कैन गेट पीपल टू स्पीक अप अगेंस्ट दिस?
ये ऐसा टॉपिक है जिस पे लोगों को एक साथ रहना पड़ेगा, तभी इस पे कोई वॉइस आ सकती है, वरना अगर ऐसे ही एक दो लोग बोलें तो ऐसे नहीं कर सकते. सबको साथ रहना पड़ेगा.
We can have a proper thing, like if there will be the proper education in schools and in colleges for the same, then I think so people will speak more.
लोगों को law की knowledge नहीं है properly. अगर उनको law की knowledge ढंग से रहेगी तो उनको पता रहेगा कि किस तरीके से क्या complain करना है, कैसे करना है. और थोड़ा सा government को police के ऊपर भी थोड़ी सख्ताई रखनी चाहिए कि अगर उनके पास ऐसे cases आते हैं तो थोड़ा उन्हें seriously handle करे.
I would like to thank Hani Khurana, Sameer Pandita, Jigyasa Khanna, and Ishan Luthra. The value of her existence is as deep as an ocean. There's no end to it. Her struggles and sacrifices are never ending. Let's have a look at the importance of women through a poetic act. Nari Astitva by Priya Mishra, Suhani Sareen, Suchi Pathak, Sufia Mirza, and Himani Sharma.
मैं लक्ष्मी हूँ.
मैं दुर्गा हूँ या काली की शक्ति हूँ. मैं नारी हूँ.
एक नया दिन, एक नया शोर, एक नया दौर, एक नया जोर. इतिहास ग्रंथ और शास्त्र का समय समय पर शोर हुआ. लक्ष्मी हूँ मैं, दुर्गा हूँ, इन नामों का दौर हुआ. आदि आदि नामों के पीछे कैसे जुड़ गए नाम अनंत. नारी नारी ना रही, बस रह गया नामों का प्रचलन. बस रह गया नामों का प्रचलन. खींच तान और जोर शोर, नारी की तू जटा न छोड़. खींच तान और जोर शोर, नारी की तू जटा न छोड़. नारी है ये क्या कर लेगी, अबला जैसे शब्द कशोर, बांध केस और कमर को कस ले, कर प्रहार तू चला कटार, मिटा अस्तित्व हैवान का और स्थापित कर नारी सम्मान, स्थापित कर नारी सम्मान। जो उठ रहे हाथों के वार, जो उठ रहे ये अनंत सवाल, जो उठ रहे हाथों के वार, जो उठ रहे ये अनंत सवाल, जान ले तू शक्ति अपनी, एक प्रहार में कर विनाश और एक प्रहार में कर विनाश। नामों का ये चलन हटा, अपनी तू पहचान बन, अंधियारे संसार में अब विश्वास की एक लौ जला, विश्वास की एक लौ जला, चीख चीख के कह दे सबसे, एक नया दिन, एक नया शोर, एक नया दौर, एक नया जोर।
Wow, what a marvelous performance. I would like to thank the participants and also Munna Saifi and Shubham for their contribution. With that note, I would now like to invite Dr. Susmita Bala, Head DME Media School, to give the concluding remarks.
Thank you, Honey. Good afternoon, everyone present here. On International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women, UN Women Chief Saima Bahous, violence against women is not inevitable, she said. She described gender-based violence as a global crisis. UN and regional experts feel that women and girls everywhere continue to be subjected to multiple forms of gender-based violence ahead of the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. They have issued a statement in this regard. Although they represent more than half the world's population, women and girls the world over are still at risk of being killed and subject to violence, intimidation, and harassment when they speak out for the simple fact of being women and girls. Violence against women and girls is a result of intersectional form of social, political, economic, racial, caste, and cultural discrimination perpetrated daily against women and girls in all of their diversity, including in the context of armed conflict, and states and the international community have the obligation mandated by international human rights law and standard to address this violence. Fighting this violence against women is our collective responsibility. This can be done at so many levels, but according to me, creating awareness will be the most effective tool in this fight. We as communicators should take up this challenge. We need to tell the world that women should be treated as humans and they are entitled to the same rights and the same status as everybody else is entitled for. I'm happy that the Students' Council's PAP has taken initiative in organizing this event of utmost importance. I am grateful to Mr. Anuj Agrawal for accepting our request and enlightening our students on the gravity of this issue. Provided lots of information, shared many cases as example, covered constitutional legal aspects. So thanks for sharing your thoughts with our students. Really, it was very interesting and rich session for us. I request everybody to take a pledge today, say no to violence against women, and create a world equal for all. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And now let's come to the conclusion of this event. I invite Dr. Teenam Bora to give the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Jigyasa. Well, at the very outset, I would like to thank the management of DME for providing us this platform to hold such an event. Of course, thanks to Dr. Amri Saxena and Dr. Susmita Bala for always encouraging and supporting us in all our endeavors. I'd like to thank Dr. Krishna Pandey, the facilitator of SPARK, for her support. Very special thanks to Mr. Anuj Agarwal for making time today to join us and giving us such important information and enlightening us with such insightful information. Thank you so much, sir. I'd like to thank the student team of SPARK, Shreya, Shruti, Honey, Jigyasa, Priya, Ananya, and all the performers who put up such beautiful acts, and the technical team, Naitik, Akshita, everyone, thank you so much for all your support. And last but not least, I would like to thank all the students who have joined, especially to the new batch for whom this was the first SPARK event which they have witnessed. So there'll be many more such events in the future. With that, thank you everyone and have a great day.
In DME, we believe in engagement and empowerment of students. And since the time this COVID-19 struck in 2020, we intensified this whole process.
For the education sector, it was a big challenge. At DME, our small dynamic team decided to take this challenge head on.
We organized different kind of programs, different webinars, wherein the distinguished people from the industry and other walks of life, they are invited to interact with the students. We try to keep them engaged in taking out newsletter, writing stories, editing stories, and not only that, they make posters, they make cartoons, they write pieces for the newsletter.
Mentoring cell at DME is a very unique feature in the ecosystem of education. While the subject teachers forge the knowledge domain strongly, it is the mentors who reach out to students in difficult times. During pandemic, when our students faced loss of their loved ones, home isolation, and several other family issues, mentors ensured that students remain cheerful, lively, and stay connected with us.
We have ensured that our students are treated with compassion, warmth, and gentle touch. And it has been our endeavor to treat all the academic activities of our students, which includes PSDA, internal assignment, and various other curricular activities accordingly.
Research cell also pays huge emphasis on interdisciplinary nature of research. In order to promote this, the research centers of the research cell were also motivated to join with each other and conduct research activities for students, faculty within DME and outside DME.
While the strong academics and great industry connect is building great lawyers, media persons and managers at DME, we at Mentoring Cell are enabling these future leaders to be compassionate, emotionally strong and resilient for any times to come.
We empower the students. All the schools of DME, they have their students council. In DME Media School, this council is SPARK. They organize the program themselves. They take their own decisions and they mobilize the students for all the good cause.
Art has the power to unite and connect during the times of crisis. Bringing people together, sharing, soothing and inspiring are powers of art, which have been made empathically obvious by the DME Cultural Societies during the COVID-19 pandemic. By taking different innovative approaches in organizing various virtual competitions and events in which the students of DME have taken part with great enthusiasm and proved that DMEans are unstoppable.
Care with compassion is motto of DME. During Corona period, we were always with our students. Their well-being is primary for us. We take care of our students.
We met the expectations of the students, of the parents, and above all, of the industry. The placements this year were better than those of the previous years. DME is committed to supporting its students in all possible ways.